Hello and welcome to Latest TV News. I'm Yael Elbroya and here are your local and national headlines for tonight. As we now focus on the recovery in our city, we look at how local businesses are getting back to work and adapting to new realities.
So we're going to be looking into the Black Lives Matter campaign again, Yael, and we're going to listen to Olivia Marshall. She was there on the march, and then Lloyd Russell-Moyle MP, the local MP for Brighton Kemptown. What's your feelings about the march over the weekend?
Big turnout. I think the interesting thing is that most reports concentrated on the fact that it was a huge turnout. And a very important one, but also a very calm one and very respectful one. And, you know, the kind of the two elements don't necessarily, you don't take it for granted that they go together. So, I mean, done to Brighton for having managed to be both very active, but also very respectful.
Yeah, and as Olivia says in her report as well, I mean, there's very young people involved in organising this, which is good news, isn't it? You know, young adults getting involved and really launching a march with... you know, thousands of people turning up.
Yeah. I mean, my 16-year-old daughter and her friends, they were very, very earnest about, you know, going there and participating and, you know, being a part of it. But, you know, people from across, you know, the age group, the backgrounds, definitely a very positive event.
Okay, we're now going to listen to Olivia Marshall and we're going to be listening to Lloyd Russell-Moyle as well about the Black Lives Matter march over the weekend.
Wearing masks, holding signs and demanding change.
Thousands of people have taken to the streets here in Brighton to celebrate the Black Lives Matter movement. They've been chanting George Floyd's name, but also chanting for systemic change here in the UK.
At 1 o'clock, a mile-long socially distanced line formed on Madeira Drive as protesters gathered for a silent protest. Bursts of sporadic applause broke the silence. Cheering was discouraged by organisers as a means of reducing the risk of spreading COVID-19. Coordinators of the day's main march were keen to emphasise the importance of taking to the streets in spite of the pandemic.
Black Lives Matter is actually, you know, as important as, you know, the pandemic, and obviously there are a few risks involved, but people are keeping a social distance, you know, we're having gloves, masks, whatever, and, you know, it's about going up and sparking the change because there's only so much we can do behind our phones. So, you know, yes, we have this global pandemic which is affecting us physically and causing death, but also the bigger pandemic is white supremacy and we need to make sure we tackle that also.
Crowds marched along the seafront before continuing up West Street. Some chose to support from their windows as the march passed by shops and homes. And then a pause in the procession. Protesters stopped on North Street to take the knee, a symbol that has now become synonymous with the Black Lives Matter movement. Tensions rose briefly as anti-racist activists passed by a group of counter-protesters at Brighton War Memorial. Police separated the two groups, but no arrests were made. Sussex police have since thanked the Black Lives Matter protesters for what they described as a peaceful and trouble-free march. Organisers were keen to maintain the peace to encourage support for their movement.
And I think now the young people are getting involved and it has to be heard and it has to impact people, really. So I think people and politicians and adults have started to sort of sit down and realise that it is actually change worldwide is needed.
Change was the main point of discussion for Black Lives Matter speakers at the level. And here in Brighton and Hove, change has already begun. The City Council has already ordered a city-wide review into all statues and monuments with links to the slave trade. In a further announcement, the Council has since pledged to become anti-racist. In an official statement, the Council expressed its desire to use the city's status as a tourist destination to influence and educate. While the protest may be over for now, we can already see the impact the Black Lives Matter movement is having on our city. Olivia Marshall, Latest TV News.
So I'm joined here today by Lloyd Russell-Moyle, MP for Brighton Kemptown, for this episode of The Vote. We're going to start off, got a lot to get through. Black Lives Matter, the campaign, it's in Brighton, it's a national campaign. It obviously started off in America. What are your thoughts on it?
I think it's really interesting. It's not, of course, the first time that there have been protests, or even protests saying Black Lives Matters. And it's not the first time in the US that there's been a death because the police have decided to murder someone in front of the public, which is what happened. Let's be very clear, that was murder, and that's what the police are going to be charged with. But I think what's different this time is that there is a real feeling that there's enough is enough, can't continue anymore, and there is a real feeling from people that after many years of not seeing progress, that we need to push to make sure this is a lasting thing. And it's not just about the US, where we know policing is completely messed up in the USA. Thousands of different police forces, different regulations, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Far too much. But also here in the UK, Sussex Police is not immune to having instances of racism in their police force. I mean, no police force is in Britain. It's not that Sussex Police Force is bad or worse or better. And many people of colour talk about how they feel victimised by how authorities treat them. I think here in this city, we've got a very good council, but even sometimes how council policies play out and people apply policies has meant that I've seen it where people of colour, black people in particular, have ended up being victimised. I'm pleased that the city has agreed to start to review things like street names and statues.
Yeah. Where do you think we will go with that review that Nancy Platt's council leader asked for? But I mean, we have the big statues. Obviously, Queen Victoria is a big one, isn't it? That we're all thinking of Grand Avenue. There's also a bust at Clock Tower. But because this is it's stirred up a big debate, hasn't it? This nationally, isn't it? The whole statue debate. I mean, do you see Churchill Square being renamed, for example? Or, I mean, where do you?
Well, look, I think that we have to. It's a discussion and we have to take things case by case.
Yeah.
And I don't think we should just be seeing this as something abnormal. Throughout all time, people have moved statues because they want them to be more prominent or less prominent. You erect statues and you take them down. That's very usual. It was done, and that's been done for hundreds of years in this country.
What do you think about the longer-term prospects then for the Black Lives Matter campaign? Do you think that we're going to see action at a national level?
Well, I hope we...
Or is it too early to tell?
Well, I do. I mean, your viewers don't know. I mean, you could broadcast these, but every Thursday I do a public Zoom meeting where I get guests in and I do a little presentation with them. I'm more than happy for you to broadcast it on latest if you wanted.
Yes.
Ever. They're all... I put them on YouTube. And yesterday I did one on Black Lives Matters. And one of the big conversations that readers, constituents were writing into me about, and we had the panelists talking about, was education. And whether we think that education needs to change, and whether we need to talk about our history better, and who needs to deliver that. Is it just your stuffy history teacher, or should people of colour, should, if you're talking about gay history, gay people, should... If you're talking about women's history, should it be women? Should they also be part of delivering it?
Mark Walker spoke to the local artists Faye Bridgewater and Katie Solohab, who have been crowned international award winners. Here is the report.
So I'm joined here today by Kate Solohab and Faye Bridgewater, both local artists. And you won awards, didn't you, Katie and Faye? Just tell us all about them.
So it's the De Wendt Art Prize, and De Wendt are a pencil manufacturer, and it's a drawing prize. So you send your work in, and I think there was something like 5,000 entries this year, and we were both shortlisted. We both live in the area, and we don't know each other, so it's really wonderful. So my piece is all about the murmurations. I run a photographic group in Brighton called Brighton Skies on Facebook, and we've got nearly 14,000 members. And when the murmurations happen, we get thousands of photos and videos of these beautiful swirling shapes of the starlings between the two piers. And I wanted to capture it somehow. So I drew 140 squares, almost like when you're flicking through your phone, going through images quite quickly, and tried to capture the essence of a murmuration. So I kind of got my pencil and I stabbed the paper, trying to get the energy of a murmuration.
Yeah. And Katie, tell us a bit about your artwork and a bit more about this prize and why you decided to enter it.
Yeah, so my artwork is a drawing of an interior space, and that's a lot of my work. It's about houses and being inside rooms, that kind of feeling of, especially empty rooms of old historic houses. I love that atmosphere. So that's what my work is about. Mine was selected from the shortlisted from 5,000 down to 70, from 70 down to one first prize winner, which was me. So I could, that was just unbelievable. I only heard about it on social media. I didn't even think of the first prize. I didn't even know there was prize money involved. So that was just incredible altogether. That wasn't why I entered. I entered just to be part of a drawing, a celebration of drawing.
So hopefully it's kind of a historic document for us all to be able to look at in the future.
And that's it for the first half. Join us for the second half for a chat to virtual doctors and an update on the Save Our Music Venues campaign. Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Mia Elbroya. Firstly, Mark Walker spoke to James Speary from Virtual Doctors about the great work which they do abroad. Here is the story.
So I'm here with James Speary, who is a trustee of Virtual Doctors. James, you're going to tell us all about your organisation, because it does some great work abroad, doesn't it? Tell us a bit more about what you do.
Okay. Hello. The Virtual Doctors is a telemedicine charity which exists to link doctors to clinicians in rural health centres, currently in Zambia and Malawi, where we are supporting about 140 health centres in Zambia and about 6 in Malawi currently. And the doctors who are in the UK provide hours on a voluntary basis to help those clinical officers in rural health centres to diagnose patients. Very often, those clinical officers in rural health centres do not have ready access to a doctor, and so therefore this technology enables that interaction to happen and for them to get the support that they need.
Yeah, this is particularly relevant at the current time of the coronavirus outbreak. Has that affected the way that Virtual Doctors carries out its work and the cases that you have?
It does, yes. Currently, if we take Zambia, for example, they have an increasing number of cases. They're doing a whole lot of testing for coronavirus. But particularly in the rural areas, it's much more challenging because, again, they don't have the facilities and the number of doctors that they need. So what the Virtual Doctors have done is we have started a COVID-19 response campaign where we are looking at wash facilities, sanitation and hygiene, and helping those clinics to get the equipment and basic PPE equipment that they need in order to do their jobs effectively.
We'll leave it there. Thanks for joining us today. All the best for the future and with Virtual Doctors. So I'm here with Nick Sayers, an artist, a resident in Brighton, and you're also a photographer, Nick, aren't you? And you've been chronicling life of lockdown, really, for many people, how they're experiencing it by doing some drawings. I think it started off for people down your street, but now you've expanded it, and you've got all these life portraits. Tell us all about it.
More or less, as soon as the lockdown started, I was kind of thinking, I'm an artist, come on, I've got to think of some sort of artistic project to respond to this unique sort of moment in history. And so I'd also been thinking I should sort of practice my drawing skills while I was in lockdown. And it's been something I've been sort of trying to sort of revive for the last few years, really. And it was just suddenly occurred to me 2 or 3 weeks ago that I could combine the two projects and draw my neighbours. And what I've always enjoyed about drawing portraits of people is you sort of sit down and it's quite informal and you can sort of chat to each other while I'm doing the drawing. And so it becomes a sort of conversation, an almost slightly sort of therapeutic sort of like encounter.
Can you show us some of the portraits then?
So I've met everyone from, this is a visual neuroscientist who lives at the other end of the street. There's a teenager. with her amazing sort of emo sort of goth fashion. This is another teenager who's had her sort of A-levels cancelled.
What are you aiming to do with this? I know you're raising money for the NHS charity, so tell us a bit about that.
My work has completely dried up as an artist because I normally go and work in schools and science events.
Yeah. Nick, all the best with the portraits. I'm looking forward to getting mine, mm-hmm. me and my wife. Look forward to that.
Cheers.
And we'll catch up soon. Cheers, Nick. Thanks.
Nice one. Thank you very much. Cheers. Cheers.
So I'm joined here today by Charlotte Lidington, who is a photographer. You've been photographing the lockdown in Brighton. Charlotte, tell us all about it, because I know you've got some very iconic images.
Yeah, we have. So there's so many different streets to capture in Brighton. And obviously, because we've been in lockdown, the lanes have been pretty empty, and there's been time for me to discover lots of different streets as well.
Yeah. What made you do this then? Because a lot of people have been looking at empty streets, and it's been quite shocking, really, hasn't it? The transformation between, you know, from a few weeks ago. But you've decided to document it in, you know, through photographs. So what gave you that inspiration?
Exactly. Well, I've had my Instagram account, Brighton.streets, for quite a while now. So for 2 years, I've always been out capturing the streets anyway. But at this time, it's obviously a bit more interesting, and I'm beginning to notice different things on the streets, and I thought it would be really nice to document the journey through everything that's happening.
Yeah.
So seeing empty streets, and if independent stores are looking different, because obviously everything's closed, so there's a lot to kind of see and capture.
Yeah. What's caught your eye in particular?
I think the lanes, in particular the north lanes, just because I'm used to walking down them and having the hustle and bustle, lots of people, everything open, and everyone kind of having that positive sense of being together. So it's caught my eye, of course, that everything's closed, and it does make for a good photo, but it's very kind of different. But this time has let me sort of see different street art and notice things I probably wouldn't have if it weren't for everything being closed.
Yeah. And so what are some of your best shots? I know you've got 10 best photos. What are they?
So I think I've got some nice captures of the seafront, like the streets on the seafront with the sunset as a backdrop. Obviously, that's always quite a nice, it always makes quite a nice photo with the I-360 as well. Then I've got some with the West Pier in the background and a lot down the lanes. I've also, if you go up towards Seven Dials, I've got lots of nice photos sort of from higher up looking down to the streets with the sea view as well, and the wind turbines in the background. And then lots of street art and captures of the north.
Yeah.
North too. But yeah, I think what makes a nice photo is the perspective and where you're standing, and also the colours. For me, I like to capture photos and then also edit them and make sure the colours all kind of link together and look really nice.
Yeah, and I know we've been seeing a lot of those during this interview. So any chance of taking this up as a full-time occupation? Because I know you work in events management, but...
Yeah, maybe in the future.
Always do quite glamorous job of photographer, doesn't it? Maybe it's not in practice, but it seems like that way, doesn't it?
Yeah. I'd love to be able to do it full-time. And yeah, capturing Brighton streets I'm really enjoying. So hopefully, but obviously at the moment, yeah, the events in Brighton have taken a bit of a hit, so... Yeah.
All right. Well, nice to speak to you, Charlotte. Just tell us your Instagram account again so everyone can take a look.
Yeah, so it's Brighton.streets.
Brighton.streets. You'll find all your stuff there. Thanks for talking to us today. All the best with the photography. Cheers.
Thank you very much. Bye.
And now for that update from the Save Our Music Venues campaign. I'm going to a party. I'm going to a party with Mark Brailsford, and you can come too, in a sense. Hello, Mark.
Hello.
Right, so I'm quite excited about this. This is a midsummer party.
Yep.
On the pier.
Yep.
Even though the pier is not quite open yet.
No, but we can feel as if we're part of it.
Yes.
So that'd be nice.
And you, of course, have been part of the kind of showbiz on the pier for many years. So you probably miss the magic that goes with performing on the pier.
Yeah, of course. Of course, you know, you miss performing in front of live audiences. And, you know, and the pier is iconic, as we all know. And, it's lovely performing anywhere at the moment. I mean, basically, in the mad times we're living in, to have any kind of celebration of live performance is a marvellous thing. So,
absolutely.
So it's very exciting that we've got this event.
So this event is not quite in front of a live audience, but people are invited, people from Brighton, from all over, are invited to come and perform live streamed, to whoever logs in on the day between 6 and 9.30. And I understand that a special mystery guest is coming as well.
Yes, from my TV show, yes. Because some of the viewers who are watching this might know that we've got the Treason show is adapted to television. So we've got a TV show running at the moment. And there are several characters, if you're familiar with the show, that are appearing in the show regularly. And one of them will be appearing, but we're not going to tell you who yet. We're going to tantalise you.
Oh, you're a tease.
I try.
So, and apart from being fun, and it will be fun, no doubt, there's also a good cause behind this event.
Exactly, Yael. And the lovely thing about this is that it is about focusing on celebrating the performing arts, live performance, and having a celebration of that, getting everyone watching together, contributing. You can log on, comment, I'm sure, on the Facebook pages, etc., on the Pier's website, and you can be part of this awareness of that Brighton is, and Hove actually, is also a hub of great live performance and venues. There's great venues here, and you know, we all need to support each other in that way as well. And obviously the people who go to see shows, and we talk about festivals as well, you know, can feel part of this, and we can all celebrate together and remember that we do have an industry in this city still, and that we will come out of this eventually. Absolutely. And we will all be stronger afterwards.
Great, so talking about supporting it and getting together, we're inviting any performers to still contact us at Latest TV. And anybody who wants to watch, to watch live on Facebook, on the Pier Facebook page, but we'll also have it edited later on and package it as a recorded, edited performance.
Exactly. There's loads of great performers. So, get involved.
Great. I look forward to it. Thank you, Mark.
Pleasure.
That's it for tonight. Join me for more of your local news stories tomorrow. Good night.